When was the first time you saw Giger's work?
Well, I'd never come across Giger's work at all. I'd been vaguely aware, once I'd seen it, of some artwork I'd seen earlier for a record sleeve, I think, Brain Salad Surgery, right? And it wasn't until I got to Los Angeles and I then knew I was going to be involved in the film. The thing about all these films, all monster films, or whatever you'd like to call it, is that the danger is how on earth are you going to finally do it? How are you going to make it, okay? And so that was one of the big concerns about how on earth it was going to be carried out, who was going to actually design it or create it. And I was shown the book, Necronomicon, okay, in Los Angeles, in fact by O'Bannon, who brought it in, and I nearly fell off the desk, said, that's it, and why look farther? And so that's how I saw it. It was as simple as that. I've never been so certain about anything in my life.
And what impressed you most about his work?
Again, it's one of those things where I think there are a lot of, say, artists in this area and of surrealism or whatever you like to call it. And I think Giger has an extra quality of, I think one of the most frightening things of all is a quality of reality combined with a sort of his own form of fantasy. And I think that's what makes it stronger, is the reality, not the fantasy. Yeah.
And was it easy to work with him?
Very, very. And in fact, I'm hoping that maybe we'll do another film very soon.
Ladies and gentlemen, will you please join me in welcoming the director of Alien, Blade Runner, Gladiator, so many wonderful, wonderful films, Mr. Ridley Scott. My first question is, how did you initially get involved with Alien?
For some bizarre reason, some bright spark was at the Cannes Film Festival and put two and two together, saw Julius and offered me Alien. You work that one out. I can't work that one out. But because I'd been just discovering science fiction, if you like, at that point, mainly through the hands of Mobius, right, and all those heavy metal comics, because I was thinking about doing something else. I was fairly brimming over with ideas and information from various sources of graphic art, really. And so when somebody sent this Alien script, I read it, and I read it once, actually. And that was in London, so I read it about, I think, finished about 10 o'clock in the morning. I was waiting, sitting on a chair, till Hollywood, Los Angeles woke up. I called up immediately and said, I'll do it.
How much opportunity did you get to rehearse with the cast beforehand? Because you create this great sense, the crew in the beginning, it really grounds everything that comes next, that they're like the crew on a 19th century whaler, and they're on their way home, and they're, you know, a few months from port.
Yeah. It struck me, I haven't seen the film for a long time, actually, and I had a glimpse of it a couple of days ago, checking prints, but on a much smaller screen. This is a large screen. And it struck me then how absolutely brilliant the cast were. A really, really special cast. And you don't do that. That's not, you know, that's good casting. That's not good directing. The priority of a director really is to cast well. If you cast well, 50% of your problems are over on the day. If you cast badly, it's a disaster, right? But in this instance, we took a long time to cast, and I think we got a definitive cast. And I was just watching tonight thinking, my God, how good they were, all of them. Because every one of them had his own little individual built-in subtext and implicit story that he didn't have to voice. It was all just part of the character. So they were very good. But I think the first time, this is my second film, and because I came from a background, remember I've done about 2,000 commercials before this, but that's essentially montage. And so whilst I was used to the process of putting images together easily, really, the first real, you know, different experience came with The Duelists, and The Duelist was really a learning process about dealing long form's easy. It was actually dealing, being able to talk language to the actors more than saying, right, this shot's going to last 2.5 seconds, so blink and smile. Got it? And in fact, there's an art to actually the process of commercial making. There's no question about that. But because this film was so brief in terms of each piece of characterization, because I think that's usually the sign of a really good script, is there's no, absolutely no fat. It's all lean. And the character, the words are really to do with what's happening, and the actors are able to squeeze in as much as they have to with this kind of film. I'm not saying this applies to every kind of movie, but bearing in mind that Alien really fundamentally is a well-done B-movie, right? That's what it is. And so when I was told that we were liked on characterization later by some critic, at the end of it, I told him to basically off, right? And said, are you kidding? Right? And so I'd get that constant questions from different actors who would be nameless within the cast who'd say, what's my character, man? What's my motivation, man? And so I thought the best thing to do was to sit down. I wrote a little bio on each of them, starting at birth through to mum, dad, university, training college, how they got into NASA, NASA projected into industry to Weyland-Yutani, finally having done Mars and Moon, yada, 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 yada. And you know what? They really loved that. And I never had to talk to them again except deal with the script. If there are any actors out there, I'm sorry, I don't really mean that. I love you, right?
Now, there's a story that certain parts of the set were actually constructed like the spacecraft, so that you had to walk through corridors to get to other corridors. Is that true? Yeah.
We didn't have the money pretty well to do anything. There's absolutely, in those days, there was no CGI. And of course, CGI today would have been very easy for anything. It would have been dead simple. We didn't even have motion control rails. There were scaffolding bars with a chap pushing them along, saying, "Nah, nah, nah, mate, you got to do it smoother," right? So when you complain about your CGI budget, don't, okay? And so all that shots of the spacecraft were basically a dolly being pushed with a good steady hand underneath the bloody model. So don't complain about your budget, okay? And so it was all actually manual. It was all by hand. It was all hand-tooled and hand-made. And but in a funny kind of way, you get very clever with a very little amount of money, you know, because it makes you think. There's a big lesson there somewhere, actually. In fact, a good example on that was Les tried desperately, had no money left, and it was up to him to make the model of the planet. And I walked in this terrible little stage, well, it's not terrible, actually, Bray Studios, and midwinter, which the heating had gone off. It was bloody terrible, actually. And Les had done the alien planet, which they were going to walk over. And it was about, alien planet was about from me to the piano. And so the mountains are about a foot high. And I looked at Les and said, it ain't going to work, is it? I mean, we put a camera down there and tried to track through it. It was ridiculous. It was like, you know, it looked terrible. So we sat staring at the model and the big croissant, which is what I call the croissant, the big alien spacecraft, and said, Jesus, you know. And I said, anybody got a home video kit? And these are just about the advent of home video cameras, and a home 8mm. And they said, I got an 8mm, I've got a video camera, so I'd get it. So I literally walked through the set with the video camera held down and approached the ship. And that's what you see on screen. And it looks, I thought tonight, wow, it looks amazing. And that was basically because, you know, it would never have passed on anything but a very sophisticated CGI, done deal. And but it looked good because you saw it through Ash's eyes, through the headsets of the astronauts, because it was being televised through the headsets back into the craft. So then Ash watches it and goes, my God. So it, funny, it gave it scale and credibility.
There's a beautiful, beautiful score for the film
by
Jerry Goldsmith. And if you look at the credits, conducted by one of the grand old men of Hollywood soundtrack composing, Lionel Newman. What was it like to work with these two? One who was kind of in younger, the first part of his career, one who was quite old.
In fact, Lionel or his brother had done the original Fox logo music, is that right?
I believe so, yeah.
It was with Jerry, Stormy. But I think, I was just thinking again tonight, my God, the score is absolutely brilliant. And I'm not yanking his chain. It was probably, I think it's one of his best scores, actually. Because it truly does nurse you through this film and leave you in constant state of tension. And I think without that score, I couldn't have let scenes run so long with nothing happening, because I decided I want to, you know, stick to a certain rigid pace and not hurry it and just let things happen. And I think it works pretty successfully. You know, I was surprised how well it, you know, stands up pretty well.
Now, was it difficult to craft the marketing campaign for the film? Was there discussion about, do we show the alien? Do we show the spacecraft? What?
No
element. Did we? Or are we going to emphasize in the poster?
Well, I think the trick is not to show you a beast, unless you've got a shark. You know, and there was that other good poster, and everybody knows what a shark looks like, right? So, I've never been able to go in the water again since. So, you know, so the only thing there to do was use the shark, I think, in this instance, because the alien was unfamiliar. Better keep him a secret till you see him behind Harry. And what we thought was the egg was a good idea. It was kind of strange. And I think that this is the best linkage I've ever had between the opening credits, titles in the movie, and the poster. I said, I wanted like a hieroglyphic. And so they said, okay, went away. And what they came up with were these strange little notches that could be fall between either being a spacecraft readout or some kind of digital clock, or a hieroglyphic, and that's what I got. I thought it was really good.
Now, because you have such a background in commercials, do you find yourself wanting to get involved in things like the marketing of the film, the trailers, or even the title? I mean, really intimately involved in the title design for your films?
Yeah, but, you know, I always try to, and there's never time, because you're all buried either cutting, mixing, ADRing or something. But yes, I do get as much as I can involved in the process. But I think, you know, film poster work, film marketing is a specialist thing. It's not, it's somehow different from advertising. Advertising is a different deal.
I think we have time for a few questions from the audience for Mr. Scott. Yes, right there.
How long did it take you to storyboard the entire film? Because I heard you had done that. And how long was your shooting schedule?
I storyboarded the whole thing in 3 weeks, and actually doubled the budget. So the value of when I used to be in art school, now my old buddies who were then lawyers, solicitors, or teachers, one of them says to me, "Hi, you're still pushing a pencil?" I said, "Yeah, that's what I'm doing." And I still find the value of everything I learned at art school. I use every day now, and so I'm able to sit down and do fairly, you know, significant boards. And boards are useful to me because it helps me to think. It's a bit like having a blank sheet of paper, getting stuck, getting writer's block, basically, and you just start. You start writing, or you start drawing, and it evolves. So I had the script, and budget was 4.2, I think. And I said, what are you going to do? I said, I'm going to go back to London. I'm going to think about it on paper, come back with something specific in about 3 weeks to a month. And I returned with the board, and they doubled the budget. So there's the value of a pencil, right?
Yeah, right here.
Really, I just love your work. Love all of it. I had a question concerning the, I guess, lost airlock scene. They claim that that was never filmed. I was just curious if any of that was ever shot.
Never got filmed. We couldn't do it, couldn't afford it. And besides, I couldn't work out in those days without CGI how to squeeze a body through a hole that big. But they did it number four.
And paid the price.
And he went white in the process, right?
I also had one other small comment. I was wondering, towards the end when Ripley's running for the ladder, it appears that the cameraman bumps her and she kind of stops and hesitates before climbing up the ladder. I was curious if that was true or not.
Yeah, no, I operate, so I was the operator in all this film. So there's Ada Biddle and I tearing along there, first of all running backwards with Ripley running over us, and then we followed her, and actually what you see in the corridor, you've got a sharp eye, is one of the electricians standing there flapping a light effect, which is just a black flag doing that. And we run straight into him. And well spotted, mate.
Yeah, over here.
Thanks again for coming tonight, Mr. Scott. I was wondering if you ever plan to return to science fiction as a genre.
Absolutely. Anybody got a script here tonight? I'll read it tomorrow.
Well, on that note, I think we should wrap up for tonight. I'd like to thank you enormously for joining us here this evening. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, will you please join me welcoming Sir Ridley Scott.
Thank you. Thanks for coming this very sad week.